guess you put the cotton in as the thing went through the fields? No? Okay, so I was not born in 64. I was nowhere near that, so of course this is not my era. So perhaps during this time, when those of you that come up to speak, perhaps you can help educate some of us younger folks so we can understand where we came from. Agreed? All right, I'm looking at one of the elders here. See if he's going to block that. And anyway, so as you know, this facility was then changed over to Carver High School. Carver, this school was named after George Washington Carver, who actually was the person who basically devised over...
Well, don't believe the hype, because I'm not her favorite brother anyway.
Oh.
Anyway, I just wanted to get up and say a few words about my experience coming out here to Arizona. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I started first grade here, and you know, I've seen a lot of things happen over the years. I mean, I can tell you some stories about this family that you guys will probably leave here laughing, probably laugh the rest of your life. But tell you, okay, I'll try to remember a few. But first, I want to get a little serious about my experience here in Arizona. You know, I came from an environment that was all black, obviously Greenville, Mississippi, pretty much still is, pretty much for what side of the trash you lived on. I remember the first day, walking to school. In fact, my mother had to walk me all the way to school because I was terrified because there's no black people here in Arizona. And I remember crying the whole way and telling her, I'm not going to school. Well, that's the wrong thing to tell my mother. I can say that right now. She said, you going to school, you're getting a whooping. You know, so, but you know, when I got to school, I was treated with a lot of respect. And I was kind of surprised because, you know, coming from an all-black environment to an all-white school, the only black kid in school, I got treated really well. And I think that was the start of my experience about a whole other world out there. And I thought, coming from an all-black world, that's just the way life is. In fact, I remember in the first grade sitting there, and I'm looking at this kid. He's not black, he's not white. And I'm thinking, he's sick. There's something wrong with him. Well, he was Mexican. And I never knew Mexican existed. This is how small my world was, or what I was used to. And unfortunately, let me backtrack a little bit. I knew the difference between races before I knew my ABC, which is sad to say about humanity. I remember driving down the street in Mississippi, and they would call us the N-word. We called them names right back, and that's a shame at the age of 5 years old. So I'm looking at this kid in first grade, and they finally told me that he's a Mexican. So I run home that day and ask my mother, what's a Mexican? In fact, she had explained to me there's a whole other race of people. And Terry just mentioned that we're multicultural now, and I think it's for the better. So I just wanted to get a little serious and let all you kids know that the younger generation, that we've come a long way, and we should be very thankful that we are multicultural, because you can't isolate yourself on one world, because the world is just not that way. Okay, had we stayed in Mississippi, I don't think we would be as successful as we are today. We've shown discipline, because we'd get our heads knocked off if we weren't. My mom, I used to think she was the meanest woman in the world. I really did. But you know what? As I grew older and I grew up, in fact, she'll tell you this, I thanked her for being so strict with me, because I would be the man I am today. And my dad, he taught and he led by example. Hardworking, get up and go to work. Don't make excuses. That's just the way it was. Okay, I'm proud to say, as a family, we never took a handout. Now, we had a family, I don't want to steal anybody's thunder, because they're going to tell you how we came out here, okay? But picture this, a black family traveling from Mississippi to Arizona in 1964. What were the chances of all of us growing up and being successful? And that's attributed to great parenting. So you kids out there that are parents now, lead by example. As you know, you can tell your kids something all day long. It's not what you say, it's what you do, okay? How's everybody here today?
Good.
I think Donald probably stole most of my lines. You know, one of the things that we talked about moving from Greenville, where it was, as you saw in like history books and on television documentaries, it was colored water fountains, white water fountains, colored restroom, white restroom, totally segregated. And I was in high school when we left there. I was in like the 10th grade. And to go from an environment that's totally segregated, just a totally black environment, to go where it's integrated to come here, it really was kind of a culture shock. But it wasn't as bad as it had been if somebody white had gone down to the black environment, because like in Mississippi, you always had to adapt to that other system anyway. So it wasn't too bad, but you know, to come there and all of us came, and I think you're probably going to see it at some point. We got a picture, I hope you display it up there, with 9 kids and my mother and stepfather in August. 115 degrees when we arrived in Chandler, Arizona. 9 kids, mother, father in a 57 Ford station wagon, no air conditioning. You know, we didn't have enough money to make a trip where you could go and investigate and find a place that you're going to be living. I mean, we had enough for one shot. I mean, it's like if you're watching a poker sale, we all in. I mean, you know, we had enough for one trip, and we all going, and we get there, and we try to find a place to stay and live once we got here. And so, and thankfully, my mother and my stepfather, they secured a place. But you know, one of the things that I want to just kind of share with you that I think is important, as Donald was reflecting about what going to this pluralistic environment where you get exposed to a broader, exposure of what the world is about, it's just really kind of amazing that we need to think about everything that we do, something just as simple as Linda Bank Johnson closing down the Greenville Air Force Base. the four places that there was a choice for us going, one Arizona. And it turns out that was the best thing for us, because like in your life, everything you do, there's a causal and an effect. So something as simple as even when you decide to go home today, the direction or the manner in which you go home impacts the rest of your life. Who you meet, the people you hang out with, people you're exposed to, influence and changes the impacts and really almost dictate the rest of your life. You know, people that you meet, even in this room, some of the folks, everybody here don't know everybody, but even people you meet and who meets you, you influence people. People influence you. You decide to make the choices that you make in life, whatever choice you make, it's going to influence the rest of your life. And so I just want to say, you know, be around positive people, influence people, be a positive influence on people you're around. And like the young folks, we got a tremendous chance to really influence them. And believe me, that's going to affect how and what they think about themselves and others as they grow older. You probably can tell I really hadn't prepared anything, but I am blessed. I really appreciate the family. Even you know, I talk to folks other parts of the country, and they even live in the same town. They never get together. We get together as often, several times a year, and it's just really wonderful that family and friends still think enough that they come and they want to share even events like this with us. So I mean, this is wonderful. So I want to thank all of you, and I have many of you, most of you are my friends, and I'm just glad to see you, because we don't know when we're going to see each other for the last time. So I do.
Terry is coming with the big hook.
No, I have a question.
What's your question? Oh,
okay.
one of the older folks, huh?
Okay. No, I'm just saying, as one of the older, you know, oldest elders.
Just come with your question. You don't need to grab it. Just come and ask the question.
My question is, do you have a memory of that road trip from Mississippi to here? Like, I know it was cramped. I know there's so many other things you could say, but something that you can share with us that's appropriate.
Well,
the
I don't know how appropriate it is, but
we're
all family.
Right?
One thing is amazing. So when you start talking about, you think about cars, and I hear people say, "Oh, you know, they really built cars in the old days. You know, they had a lot of metal. Cars are not built as good. They're much better built today than they were then. For example, that 574 station wagon. This is 1964 that was coming out here. 7 years old. The floor pan was rusted out, you know, behind the front seats. I mean, really. So, this is probably the off-color part, but it's true.
I got to do it.
So, you know, so you got kids out here, and you're going down the road, and you know, like I said, you know, I'm going, "Yeah, yeah, I gotta go," you know. Well, you know, if you pull up that little pad, that little thing, we have like a little plywood coming. The boys, the girls had a little problem. The boys, I mean, you just pull up there and you just kind of, as you go down the road, you didn't even slow down, you know. So I'm not looking at a prescription. So that's one of the things that I remember, you know. So
I'm glad I asked.
That was one of the things that I remember. So
all right.
On that, I think I'll end with that.
Yeah, okay. Appreciate it.
Next, we will have reflections by Patricia and Tobin. Patricia Ann, let's give it up for Patricia Ann.
That's okay, because I am. And to the point where I have to make some notes, but a lot of my information has already been taken by those that are older than I. And so I wrote a few things down, and I tried to make it like a poem, but it didn't work out. So I just basically started like this: packed like nothing I've ever seen, even going to church on a Sunday eve. An adventure was upon us like no other, so we thought, my sisters and brothers. We're headed to Arizona. At least we didn't have to stop to chop cotton or to pick it. As we went across the Arkansas Bridge in the Mississippi River, I wondered if we would ever have to stop and look at a water fountain, see, that was already taken, to see if it was white or colored. My grandmother used to say, "Patricia Ann, those white folks are gonna get you if you keep drinking out of that water fountain, out of that cool water." But I always ask, "Well, how come my granddaddy can drink that water and not me?" And I never got an answer. Because you see, my granddaddy looked just like the white folks. And I never got an answer on that either. I remember once stopping for gas, and I wanted to get some of that double mint gum, you know, where they have the double mint twins. You see the commercials? Double your pleasure. And the lady asked, told me it would be a nickel, but I had to go to the back door. And you know, if you go to my mom's house right now, you have to go to where? The back door. It has nothing to do with gum. But I got back to the car, and I remember my mom asking, "What was the gum I went to get?" Well, I valued that nickel that was so valuable to me, but I wouldn't buy the gum because the lady wanted me to go to the back door. I just got back in the car and kept my nickel. I refused to go to the back of any line or into the back door because I had pride in myself, which I was taught by my family. And how do you get 11 people in a 6-passenger station wagon? I think that's really an accurate question. Answer anyone? You know that movie, Answer, with that kind of dumb looking professor standing there? Answer anyone? I don't know. How do you do it? You pack them in, you have a direction, You have somewhere you want to go, you have a job, you have a family you want to take care of, you get across the desert, and you get to Arizona. But what didn't get here was our clothing. We got here, we had no clothes, the clothes went to Chicago or some part of Illinois. And we got here, and we ended up staying in a hotel, and it was a Redwood Hotel, and I think it still exists in Chandler. And it was red. I started to wear a red dress today, and that would have shocked everyone, because you hardly ever see me in red unless it's Christmas. But we stayed in the hotel. I think the boys stayed on one side, and the girls stayed on the other. I also had a red dress in Mississippi, and I hated that red dress because I had to wash it out and wear it 2 days a week or 3 days a week. The Redwood Hotel. We went to Chandler High School, and we were the very nice kids because we came here saying yes ma'am and no ma'am. We were the perfect people. We lived in Chandler next to, and I can't say the family's name.
It seemed like a never-ending road trip, especially whenever Daddy was behind the wheel. Instead of asking the typical question, are we there yet? I often ask, when are we going, when are we going to get to Alexander? The long highway limited us to access to a restroom, which prompted one of my siblings having to make a quick dash into the woods. As we continued our travel, someone's pillow fell out of the back window. Eager to get to our destination, there was no turning back. We later visioned unfamiliar nature, such as picturesque mountains and many miles of cactus and rocks. A lot different in comparison to the Mississippi State flower, the magnolia, and the green grass of home. One night, I had awakened to a strange smell. Looked out the window and saw cows being hauled down Arizona Avenue. With much excitement, I said, that means we are finally in Arizona. To my surprise, Arizona was a culture shock. I wasn't used to being called racial slurs on a daily basis. It took some time to be acknowledged for my character, minus the color of my skin. A character that was emulated as a result of my parents' positive and good example. Arizona began to grow on me. I've learned that it takes all kinds of people to make the world go around, and some are not going to like me. I also found Arizona to be a place of opportunity. I've had the pleasure and opportunity to meet some very kind and caring people throughout my stay, which included my wonderful husband and those of you who have gathered here today. Thank you.
Those reflections could not have happened without this young lady that's coming forward. She has kept this family together through thick and thin, through with and without, through prayer, through giving grace, mercy, discipline. That's necessity. Patricia? Thank you, Jason. And I thank you too. Let's give it up.
My husband and I was employed at Greenville Air Force Base, Mississippi. And one day we received a letter to inform us that the base was going to close. But we had a chance to move to whatever base we want. In fact, it was three different bases. My son said some other base, which I didn't know about that. But all I know was she knew that was based in Illinois. And Blondie, Arkansas, and Williams, Air Force Base, Arizona. I want to go to Illinois because I want to see the bright lights of Big City. But he didn't want to go to Illinois. He said it's too cold. So we chose Arizona. Now, Greenville was known as the Queen City of the Delta. I have a couple back there can witness that. They're from Greenville. But that's one thing that came to my mind that made me proud of leaving Mississippi. The racism was very, very strong. One thing I remember, I'll never forget. There was someone supposed to be working for the health department in Greenville, and he was going around checking people's houses to see what kind of condition was in. So they came and checked mine. It was really clean. And he said, oh, your house is so clean for all these kids. So I'm going out and check the garbage can. He went out and checked the garbage can. It had a hole in the bottom. Excuse me if I said tears, cuz it brings back memories. He said, your garbage can have a hole in it, and we're going to fine you $15. If you don't have $15, we take you to jail. And guess what? They took me to jail. We didn't have the money to pay the $15 fine. So my son, James, Lon, Floyd, had just came from the field, chopping cotton, and they bailed me out. So they did take me for an improper garbage can. So this was called the Queen City of the Delta. In 1964, 25th of August, we started on our journey. It was a trip I never forget. I know this has been repeated more than once, but I do it again. The temperature was 115 degrees. 11 people in a 19 Ford station wagon with no air. Pilot seat in the back was missing. We covered a hole in the seat with a cargo. The Beverly Hillbillies had nothing on us. So we ride in Chandler, and we didn't know where we were going. I don't know why we stopped at the Redwood Motel. Maybe God sent us there. The owner was a retired Air Force major. And after being in the military for so many years, he understood our situation. He had only two rooms left, but we were glad to get there. The next morning, he gave us a newspaper to look for the real ads to see whether to buy the house ready. The very first house I saw that I liked, I got the phone number and I called this person. She said, well, I'll be out there tomorrow to talk with you. So when she came out and saw me the next morning, you should have seen that strange look on my face. She said, Mrs. Hinton, I can't give you an answer right now. And it's not because of your color, but I don't know if I can rent a house where there's 9 children. She said children would be children. But let me go home and pray on this. And whatever God tells me to do, I'll do that. And I contact you tomorrow. So that's what she did. She came back, she said, I'll let you have a house, but with one condition. You have to pay $10 a month for the wear and tear of of the house. And give me the privilege to come back once a month to check the house, see what kind of condition it's in. Well, I said, that's okay. Because if I had, well, I was in the house with 9 kids, I would have second thoughts too. And we moved a few things we had when I bought little things in that bunk bed so the kids had some sleep in them to help them get out of the fudge again. Now, and the next day, I went to the base to apply for a job. I was hired that same day. But what I didn't like about Arizona was the cotton field, because I just left a cotton field, and I don't see that anymore. And I thought I had got away from that. But one thing was so funny. There were so many people with the first name spelled J-E-S-U-S. I said, it's just going to be back in name Jesus. So someone explained to me about the name Jesus was in Spanish. One thing I'm more than happy that we had a chance to go to Arizona. My children has had a better chance for education, a chance to fulfill their dreams and to know there's more than might than what Mississippi had to answer to offer. And my life has also been a better chance for education. Things I was involved in that made my life better. We're truly blessed that we came this far. After 50 years of grace, and in my closing, I would like to share with you one of my favorite scriptures, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord always, and lean not to thy own understanding. In all thy ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct thy path. Thank you.
Don't know what it is, but I hear that it's special.
Very nice, Virginia. I really appreciate that. Next, we'll have a very special lady. I think Terry's not what I'm supposed to do, but I'm going to do it anyway. I'm not supposed to do that. No, okay. Do the special guest? Yeah, okay. All right, so we have another special guest. I don't even know who it is, but they're special. I'm happy they're here, I think. And let's give it up for the not you, sit down. Let's give it up for our special guest. I feel good. I feel good.
Carol.
I feel good.
Carol. Yeah.
Shh. I feel good.
You said too much. Please, please.
Come on.
Ow! I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't. Ow! I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't.
Can you help me, please? can breathe. Right now, right back down. Hold my knees. And oh, there were times when I thought I would last for long. But right now, I'm able to carry on. It's been a long
excitement, come on.
Happy birthday.